mentioned at the beginning that I think Tony's great characteristic is clarity of thought, and I think we've just had a wonderful example of that as we went through that very bleak, but I think very stark analysis. We move on to the Q&A, which Tony has agreed should remain on the record. So that, I think, is a very good thing. Who would like to start?
Well, my name is John, and I'm a simple member of this institution. No, it's in relation, you did mention one of our negotiating team, Boris, of course, but the other two, Fox and David Davies. Simply, what do you think of them? Do you think that they'll make a good job?
Well, their inclusion in the government was probably necessary, given the role they played in the referendum campaign and the need for Theresa May to incorporate the most significant strands of opinion in the parliamentary party with such a small majority. I think from what I gather, Liam Fox's perhaps not quite as much as Boris Johnson on the international stage. He doesn't sort of rub people up quite as much the wrong way as Boris Johnson. But one hears a few things that to suggest that he can exasperate people a bit. He claims to be particularly well connected in America, but that was America before Trump won the election, so I'm not sure quite. But he's been busy. He's travelled there a lot. I believe he has been trying to set up sort of trade offices, small trade offices around America, in anticipation of the time that there would be some serious trade talks. I don't think he's regarded with sort of complete confidence by everybody in the Parliamentary Conservative Party. As regards David Davis, well, he seemed to begin in office with a somewhat more abrasive tone than he has adopted more recently. He's something of a more, I wouldn't say an unknown quantity in Brussels, because he was once the Europe Minister. We would just have to see. I mean, he that ministry is bit by bit becoming something of a power centre in the government. So I think he's got to be taken pretty seriously. Whereas what one can say about Liam Fox, obviously, is that it's hard to see quite what he's doing until the moment comes when you can actually strike these deals. But he has, the idea that everybody in the world is sitting back saying, oh, we can't do anything with Britain, isn't quite right. I mean, there are some countries that have been talking, and he's been involved in that.
Okay, the sequence is Alan Dukes, firstly Neville Keary, and then Ron Hill, and then I move later on to Brendan. Okay, Alan, please.
Yeah, Alan Dukes, a member of the Institute and former Minister for Finance during the Thatcher era in the UK. I mean, one of the ironies of the situation, I think, is that, it's been pointed out, Thatcher was a great proponent of the single market. And indeed, I remember Lord Cofield as a UK commissioner pushing the case at ECOFIN. It's a shame to see that being turned around. Mrs. May didn't speak about her great reform bill the other day. My understanding of that was that it would import into UK legislation all of the various directives that have been adopted in the last 43 years, effectively putting regulation standards and so on in the UK at the same level as the European Union. Is there a basis there for at least a discussion about equivalences that would have the effect of maintaining some of the advantages of the single market for the UK? Second, if during the course of the negotiations, the UK had the chutzpah to say, once we're out, we will offer you complete free trade, tariff-free trade, if you'll do the same for us. Wouldn't it be very difficult for the EU to refuse that? And then linked with those two, I noted you said that you felt that there would have to be a certain parallelism in the negotiations between, if you like, the divorce agreement and what happens afterwards. It seems to me that we've got hung up about transitions. You know, and I recall that when the UK and Ireland joined the EEC, we had a transition period for going from where we were before to the stated objective of full membership. It doesn't seem to me to be entirely impossible to imagine the reverse process. And if there is parallelism in that regard in the negotiations, does that not give some hope of getting a more rational conclusion to the whole process?
Yeah, I mean, I understand it in precisely the way you did, that they incorporate the laws as they've accumulated over 40 years, and then if and when it's judged necessary to alter things, then that would happen. But I mean, I don't see a kind of storm of immediate changes happening after the incorporation of EU legislation. I mean, we'll have to see where the pressures build up, possibly from business, possibly from within the Conservative Party itself. But I mean, I think one's got to look slightly beyond the initial period. I mean, over time, there will be changes adopted by the EU27 to business regulation, and I think my concern would be that it's difficult to see the British Parliament matching those sort of tweaks in the legislation, or even entirely new forms. I'm thinking of things like the digital sector and so on. So I think the scope for some divergence is actually quite real. But not in the early stages, that's true, perhaps so much. On the offer of a kind of total free trade, I think the problem is that you can imagine things getting bogged down, particular sectors. Even something that might seem relatively unimportant from a British point of view, agriculture, actually it has the potential for a lot of political friction. I mentioned aerospace. She didn't in her speech, but there are the scope for one side pushing back against the other, and not in the direction of complete free trade. It's got to be fairly high, I think. It would, at a minimum, need intervention from heads of government to keep things on track if it was going to go in the direction you suggest. That's not impossible, of course. The parallelism of the talks, if, as I suggested, one of the first things that comes up once the discussions start is this question of the so-called bill for leaving. Well, I don't think you can imagine trade talks happening simultaneously with that. I mean, it's a funny one, the bill for leaving, because even before you start talking about a number, you've got to start talking about what are the areas that generate a bill, and what time frame are we talking about. And I mean, I'm not aware that an awful lot of work has been done on this. I mean, I'd hope there are people looking at all this now, but so I mean that's the problem, I think. But let's say that somehow managed to be less bitter a discussion than is imaginable. Then I think yes, there comes a point where you would need to start talking about the future relationships simultaneously, because they become entangled together too much. I mean, it just doesn't make sense to try and do the one without the other. But 2 years for all that? No. I mean, nobody I don't see that at all.
Okay. Neville, please.
My name is Neville Keary. I'm a member of the Institute. I'd just like to make what may seem a very crude and simple point. The more I try to follow this, the more I think that Mrs. May has simply two questions in her head. One, how can I keep the Conservative Party together? And two, how can I keep it together in a way that will enable me to win the next general election? And I think that's the driving force and the questions she will ask. And it's awful that it leads inevitably to the contradictions that you've so set out so well.
Well, what can you say? Party politics, yes. That's the consequence of being in a democracy, I suppose. But it's also the consequence of the small majority she has in Parliament. I mean, it was party politics which partly explained the calling of the referendum in the first place, was it not? And with the perceived threat of UKIP, which turned out in the end not to, you know, to be a bit of a phantom. Yes, it is a reality. It is about party politics, and not only, of course, on the British side. I mean, it's party politics which will have quite a big influence over the attitudes taken by governments around Europe. And one of the places where huge efforts are made, I'm thinking of Germany, to have a kind of consensus position on things like attitudes to Eurozone crises or attitude. One sees there that this is getting harder and harder to do. That does give one pause for concern about whether it would be possible to keep a level head on around in the discussions and keep in mind what logically ought to be the common objective, which is a close relationship in all areas, including trade and investment over the long term. It's not, I didn't want to give you call this sort of stark message. I didn't want to sound like I was being pessimistic about this. Mm. The objective is clear. The road there is not so clear. But I don't want to suggest that it's all going to fail.
I mean, in the FT today, there is a piece by Wolfgang Matthau, which is arguing that basically there's enough, if you like, high politics, which have as, you know, which require a basic deal to be made, and that will win through.
Yeah, and I think that it's plausible. The to come back to the point of it, party politics. I mean, Theresa May is very, very conscious that it's been the European issue that has destroyed one Tory party leader after another. She won't want to be the next one, you know, in line to be dethroned because of Europe. Even though the pro-Remain segment of the parliamentary party has kind of fallen in now behind the idea, well, this is what we've got to do. She's not entirely liked or trusted, or the views don't chime completely with quite large sections of the party, I think. And you know, don't forget, you have a king in waiting in the form of George Osborne. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Ron, please, and then Brendan after that, and then Portrick.
My name is Ron Hill. I'm a member of the Institute. I was a political scientist for many years. The question of the border. It strikes me that much of what Theresa May is up to is pursuing the agenda that she had when she was Home Secretary. Her obsessions are those of the court, immigration, various, the foreigners, all, the things that she wouldn't allow her to do what she wanted to do when she was Home Secretary. Now, only one of her very few sallies out during the campaign, she was supposed to be a Remainer, she went to Northern Ireland a couple of days before the referendum, I think the 21st. And I distinctly remember her seeing her on television. This hasn't been picked up, I think, very much in the mass media across the water, maybe because it was in Northern Ireland just 2 days before the referendum. She did say quite distinctly, and I checked this on the internet yesterday, that the inevitable consequence of Brexit is a border with customs control and all the rest of it. Yet now she comes up with, I think, item number four, wasn't it, not having a border. Which is the real Theresa May? Have you any real sense of where she's... and if the latter, then is there anything we can do about it?
Well, yeah, I mean, I agree with you that because her, overwhelmingly her experience of government was in these areas associated with the Home Office, that has shaped her thinking quite considerably. Of course, the longer she's Prime Minister, the more she will, one imagines, get a more rounded picture of and I think her apparent interest in sort of redesigning British industrial policy is a sign that there's something there that, you know, wasn't associated with her before. So there are some signs it's broadening out a bit. On the border question, well, I mean, the Remain camp tended to make this point. You know, it would be irresponsible to vote out to be out of the EU because you immediately inject a severe problem into relations with Ireland. You have a border, which is the last thing we want. She may have just been echoing that referendum campaign point without actually thinking that in practice that would be what happened. I recall the previous Northern Ireland secretary in Cameron's government saying to me about a month or so before the vote, absolutely not. We're not, you know, we're not even going to consider anything that would jeopardise the common travel area. So I think it might have been a kind of referendum campaign thing that she said. I mean, certainly the position now is very much not at all. We don't want hindrances to the CTA.
Brendan Lynch, and then Patrick Murphy, and then Noel Dorr.
Tony Blair recently raised the possibility that the UK wouldn't leave the European Union in the final analysis. What do you think of the possibility that there would be no Brexit in the end?
Well, I recall about a month or so after the vote, meeting the president of Latvia who was passing through London. You might say, well, it's Latvia and, you know, not one of the larger EU states. But he said exactly the same thing. He said, I just can't see that this is going to happen. And at the time, I thought, well, you know, there are a number of people from Central and Eastern European governments who really were in a state of shock over this, because they'd seen Britain as a kind of pillar of support for the enlargement, and then the defence and security angle was terribly important for them, and also the presence of so many citizens from their countries living and working in the UK. So there was a sort of state of shock, and I thought, well, he's just expressing that state of shock. But as time passed, well, you know, I've run into a few American policymakers, admittedly from before the November election in the States, who said something similar. And as you mentioned, Tony Blair, I mean, I've got to say, I find this not very likely. I just can't see it. I mean, if things are driven, as we were saying, by party politics to a lot, you know, in many ways, well, the dynamic of the party political scene in Britain is very much towards launching the exit negotiations and leaving. And what are the forces, politically speaking, that would resist this? I mean, they're concentrated in the Lib Dems, a rump minority in the Tory parliamentary party and some in the Labour Party, or although they're demoralised in the Labour Party because they don't know if they're going to get wiped out in their electoral heartland the next time there's an election because of the EU stroke migration stroke worthy. So I can't see it myself. Of course, nothing is static in politics, diplomacy. I mean, the landscape could shift in coming years. But from the point of view of the political outlook in Britain at the moment, I don't see it.
Certainly, Padraig at the back. I think, Padraig, you wanted to ask a question, and then Noel after that, please.
Padraig Murphy, a member of the Institute. Well, yes, it's about party politics, of course. It has to be, but it's about an awful lot more than party politics. And I want to mention particularly the element of Theresa May's speech, in which she talks about engaging in cooperation on security and intelligence with the EU. This, of course, can be regarded as a way of giving herself negotiating leverage. But for 43 years, the United Kingdom and the European Union has been saying that security and intelligence is no business of the EU, and has been a proponent of the thesis that to develop a EU capacity in these areas would be to diminish the commitment of the United States to the security of Europe, which was regarded as quite crucial. Now we have a situation where Berlin and Paris are beginning to talk about developing a security capacity for the European Union against the background of a new American president who has said that NATO is obsolete and that at a minimum, he is not committed to the European project. At the same time, Theresa May, it seems, is intent, and she's going to Washington, is it next week or later this week, in order to advance this, to develop further her relations with precisely this American administration. It seems to me there's a kind of circle there that cannot be squared.
You're right, of course, that the Prime Minister has been almost scrambling in the last few weeks to send signals that she wants the relationship with the Trump administration to be close. I mean, apart from the fact she's going there in a few days' time, there was the very unusual criticism of the Obama administration's Israel policy, I think we've got to separate when we talk about security, defence, counterterrorism, intelligence. I mean, they don't fall under precisely the same headings. There's the NATO element, of course, which is the collective defence, and one imagines she's going to Washington to try and make sure that there's absolutely no putting into question of that. The intelligence, the so-called Five Eyes arrangement between Britain, America, Canada, New Zealand, Australia, I think that is something that they value extremely highly in London. I mean, it's at a level which is beyond anything that goes on between European governments, and again, I imagine she'd want to be shoring up that. But then separately, there is the issue of crime fighting and which includes counterterrorism to some extent in within the current EU, and she, of course, she's experienced in that area through Europol, and it's been noticeable that since the referendum, the British government has taken steps to keep Britain's place in Europol, and one could imagine that in some form or another continuing actually. Because it is a useful way of pooling efforts to deal with terrorist threats, but that's something distinct from from the collective defence of NATO. To what extent would she find it difficult to knit these together into a coherent stance on what we would broadly call security? Well, I think it really depends on what goes on in Washington under the Trump administration. I mean, this is the problem. You know, it may not be the case that all bets are off exactly, but you know, there's a lot of uncertainty there. But that will be absolutely critical in determining what direction this goes in.
No, please, and then Martin.
I hesitate to intervene because Porrick Murphy has asked almost exactly the question I was going to ask. With just a slight, I'll perhaps give a slight variant of it. His question, and you turned it much more to the United States and intelligence and security in the sense of anti-terrorism. I was wondering if, as the talks begin, the UK will need to have cards to play, and one strong card is its armed forces and its defence role in Europe. Mm. And I've just wondered, granted the possibility of a hands-off approach from Trump, if that will play into a wish in France and Germany, and therefore a beginning to develop at least one set of links in the defence area that have not been very well developed so far. Mm. It will come out of the need for the UK to retain links which do not cut across the economic and migration areas, and perhaps a desire in France or elsewhere to build up the defence role. And I'm just thinking ahead, would that then be a way of building kind of new sort of links, even though Britain leaves the EU? It's a variant only of the question you've just answered, so you may have covered most of it.
No, there are extra angles to consider on this. I mean, I know some people have said that the references she made to Britain's defence contribution in Europe and the quality of the intelligence work that the British intelligence services do, all this, you know, you out there and the rest of Europe, you should make sure you appreciate all this, as if it were a sort of card to play. If it is, I don't know, I think it's playing with fire a little bit, because as I say, the fundamental defence guarantee involves NATO and the US commitment to Europe. The British contribution is under that umbrella, and to the extent that the American commitment is brought into question or diminished, well, you know, that impacts the effectiveness of the British commitment. So I think you know one needs to think twice before making any sort of linkage like that. As regards whether it would, all this would stimulate closer Franco-German defence cooperation, putting themselves at the front of some wider European defence initiative. Well, there are two things to think about here. I mean, one is, although we can't predict the outcome of the French presidential election, if we were to assume that François Fillon won, I'm not sure he would go down that road of a closer defence relationship with Germany. I mean, he's really a dyed-in-the-wool Gaullist, and he says pretty clearly, one of my first priorities is to reassert France's sovereign role as a defence power and get a better relationship with Russia. I'm not sure his priority is to defence cooperation with Europe. The second thing is whether modern Germany really wants to be put to the front on an issue like defence and the security of Europe in this way. I know they've produced government papers, sort of considering this and everything, but you know, overall the kind of feeling in German society is far from united on this point. And indeed, polls have been done, I think by the Pew Research Center, country by country, on, you know, to what extent do you take seriously the commitment to the collective defence of the Eastern European members of NATO, and the support for military action, if one of them comes with it, is pretty low in Germany. I mean, it's not that high in most of the NATO countries, actually. So I'm not sure that's really there in Germany. And then the third thing is, you know, at a time of pretty severe budgetary strains all around EU member states, I mean, are we really going to see money being diverted into defence in any meaningful way? I mean, I can't see. It looks doubtful to me.
How much do we need to be concerned by the strand of thought whose ambitions go a lot further than just a good deal, but who would like Brexit to be the beginning of the unravelling of the EU? Michael Gove, perhaps we had a lucky escape, has talked about the liberation of Europe. And it's perhaps not without significance that the then president-elect, first of all, received Nigel Farage and wanted him to be ambassador, and then gave his first important interview to a British newspaper to Michael Gove. I mean, you have the extraordinary situation of an American president who appears, or at least before he became president, appeared to be calling for the breakup of the EU.
It's very concerning. There's no question about it. One should keep in mind that first of all, let's take the situation in Washington. I mean, there are. People among the set of nominees for his administration who wouldn't agree with what he said, and then there would be a very, very large body of opinion in Congress that wouldn't agree with it either, let alone the entire foreign policy and defence establishment in Washington. So to that extent, one perhaps needn't fear that the sky is about to fall in. As regards the British politicians who've made these kind of remarks about sort of setting Europe afire and liberating it, I mean, this speaking as somebody who's spent most of my career on the continent of Europe, there's no question it comes across as either idiotic or threatening. And it absolutely doesn't go down well at all.
Andy, and then Murray, and I know Alan wants to go back in again, but Andy first.
Andy O'Rourke, I'm a member of the Institute and a former Irish civil servant. Looking on the bright side of things, one might perhaps say that after Lancaster House, the Brexit procedure has clarified itself a little bit and perhaps become a little more simple, in that before Lancaster House, it wasn't clear what the future relationship would be, which needs to be taken account of in the negotiations for Britain's departure. After Lancaster House, it seems clear, at this stage at least, that Britain's future relationship with the European Union will be that of a third country. So, and let us hope that to be optimistic that these negotiations will go well. The issue now is getting from its present status as a member state to that of a third country with our negotiating for a free trade agreement without any sort of train crash occurring. Mrs. May is going to Washington on Friday next and will be talking, among other things, with President Trump about trade. I just wonder whether a situation where Britain is negotiating trade agreements or talking about trade agreements with other third countries is going to complicate or even give an excuse for further complications in the negotiations taking place during the two-year period from March next. And I wonder, have you got a comment on that?
If I've both had the occasional contact with people from the sort of countries that the British are thinking it would be relatively... It would be a good idea to do early childhood with, and it might not be too complicated. I'm thinking of places like Canada, Australia. The governments of those countries and the business communities of those countries are conscious that you can't jump the gun. You've got to wait and see, you know, how the negotiations between Britain and the EU unfold. That said, there is some enthusiasm. It's not just Liam Fox's imagination. There is some enthusiasm for doing something relatively soon, when it's legally possible. I didn't really see it complicating the UK-EU talks, because I don't think a trade minister in Canada or Australia or wherever would be. I mean, they'd know there are certain legal processes that have to be followed. So you never know, of course, but I wouldn't expect it to be a matter of friction during the actual talks. No. By the way, I think it'd be a lot harder to strike a deal quickly with the United States. I think that's more difficult.
Murray, please.
Murray Cross, member of the Institute and former member of the Department of Foreign Affairs. The Foreign Affairs Ministry in Britain seems to be pushed a bit down the pecking order, I'm afraid. Just my question to come back. We touched briefly on the Labour Party in Britain, and it's almost extraordinary that we're kind of scrubbing it out of consideration, because we're talking here of the main opposition party. So my question is, how do you see the Labour Party role in the Brexit negotiations and in general the sort of future of the Labour Party at the moment?
It's very important, this. The short answer is that they are hobbled, of course, at the moment by the problem that they have a leadership which is lukewarm at best about was lukewarm at best about the EU in the first place, tended to see the EU in those old kind of 1970s terms as a kind of monster of, they used to be called multinationals, if you remember back then. I think we called them something else. But anyway, a kind of evil capitalist machine eating up everything in its path. And the more kind of internationalist pro-EU side of the parliamentary party has been very demoralized by this, and slowly but surely it's been losing its hold on the machinery of the party. So changing that quickly is not going to happen. The shadow minister who is representing the Labour Party's stance on Brexit and Parliament is quite a substantial figure in his own right, but he doesn't have the full support of the party leader. So again, he's sort of somewhat hobbled. You know, we have just had the French Socialist Party first primary yesterday, in which something similar was visible in a kind of division between a more radical left and a more moderate left. People are expecting that no matter who the candidate eventually is in April and May, that they'll lose, and that in the subsequent parliamentary elections in France that they will be absolutely decimated. And I think there is this very, very similar fears for the Labour Party in Britain. I'm not entirely convinced that this means that they're going to be kind of eaten alive by UKIP, though. I don't think that is necessarily the case. I think that things change in the course of time, but it seems to me that UKIP has problems of its own in coming across as a sort of responsible, well-led, efficient. I mean, they're not. It's just they're all over the place. And So I think, you know, the risk is perhaps more that you'd get a very large Tory landslide.
We're coming towards the end, and Alan usually wants to get in for a second bite of the cherry.
Yeah, my apologies for that.
No, it's okay. Thank you.
There's a constitutional issue that seems to me hasn't yet been much examined. Nicola Sturgeon emphasises the fact that a majority of people in Scotland voted to remain. Sinn Féin and the SDLP have the same claim in Northern Ireland. The Welsh don't say anything because, of course, they voted to leave. And I wonder what the meaning is of that. This wasn't a series of simultaneous referendums in the jurisdictions of devolved governments. It was a national referendum in a national jurisdiction where the responsibility for the issues involved rests with Westminster and with the government in London. And some of the argument seems to me to be, and this trivialises it a little, and I hope I won't offend my good friend John Connor, and I say this would be like saying that of all the counties in Ireland, Roscommon is the only one that doesn't have to allow same-sex marriage, because they voted against it in the referendum. But it seems to me that there is an issue to be looked at there. We have concerns with the border, we have concerns with trade and all those economic relations with Northern Ireland. But it seems to me we do need to look at the whole of the Belfast Agreement and come to some clear view as to what parts of it, if any, will be affected by a Brexit and what parts of it will not be at all affected by a Brexit. In my ignorance as a simple economist and not a constitutional lawyer, it seems to me that references that I've heard to the implications of Brexit for the constitutional position of Northern Ireland are entirely misplaced, because it seems to me that the reference in the Belfast Agreement to how changes might or might not come about in the constitutional position of Northern Ireland relate only to its constitutional position as part of the UK. Is that the case? And in any case, whether it is or not, do we not need to look clearly at each of the provisions in the North, the Belfast Agreement, to see to what extent, if any, they are affected by Brexit?
And you will have read the excellent piece in the FT this morning linking some of these constitutional issues to the Supreme Court pronouncement tomorrow.
Well, yeah, I mean, the issue that I think is bound to come up in some kind of legal test has got to be the fact that the Good Friday Agreement, it's embedded in, in EU, it's in a protocol, is it not? A protocol to a treaty, I believe. Yeah.
Lodged with the UN.
It was deposited at the UN. Mm. But everything about the agreement is predicated on the idea that you have each side in the EU, and that it's easy to foresee a moment when there's some sort of challenge it would probably be to the European Court of Justice, where somebody says, I have certain rights that according to the streets of mine as a citizen of Northern Ireland, but it's within the EU frame, and they take it to the ECJ, and then what does the ECJ do? I mean, if they, it would be precisely the sort of issue that would rile the forces in Britain who said, well, the whole point of leaving is to stop this sort of thing happening. So, I mean, I would expect that to come up. Of course, it could equally well come up, although we're diverging a bit from Northern Ireland here, but it could equally come up in the form of some, you know, an English person or a Scottish person saying, I've got certain rights and I want them upheld. But I think that, that's going to be very, very, very awkward indeed to sort out. As regards the point about, well, it was a collective vote, you know, in the state of the United Kingdom and Northern Ireland, and you can't just start unpicking it, saying this constituent country voted this way and the other way that way. I mean, don't forget, there was a massive vote in favour of staying in the EU in London, and there's a lot of people in London who say, well, why don't we have some special arrangement? Because, you know, we don't feel anything in common with. Yeah, but it's not going to happen.
Well, we've come to the end. It's been a fascinating hour and a quarter, Tony. Thank you. I mean, you did study modern history in Oxford, and overlaying on this has this starting point has been three decades of, you know, wonderful expertise about European politics, and all of that has been expressed here today. It's been a great contribution. We're really grateful to you for it, and we hope we'll see you back again at some future stage.